Hello friends, welcome back to my channel. My name is Chelsea. If you are new here, if you are not new, welcome back. I appreciate you coming back. You're the realist. If you are new, please do subscribe. And also if you're not new, please check if you're subscribed. Apparently it's like making people unsubscribe. I don't know. Feel free to follow me on Instagram. My Instagram is at @IamCCSuarez. My Reddit community will be linked down below as well. I love talking to y'all in there and on Instagram. And then also my merch is linked down below. If you would like a big yikes shirt, a stay spicy shirt, a mug, this is not one of them. Obviously, this is from Target. But there's mugs too that say super cute things on them. So that'll be linked below as well. Feel free to check that out. If you would like to watch any of my other true crime videos, feel free to click the little icon up in that corner. I want to say this is like my fifth one. As you're watching those, you'll probably be able to tell like I'm kind of all over the place, right? I'm trying to like figure out how to do these videos because just talking to the camera can be really awkward. Like, look at me. I don't know what to do with my hands right now. But I want to be original. I don't want to copy what someone else does. I do love Bailey Sarian a lot. Feel free to like just binge all of her videos. They are absolutely, absolutely amazing. If you like true crime content, even if you don't, doesn't matter. She's amazing. I will have a couple of my favorite true crime creators and podcasts and things like that linked down below too. But let's go ahead and get into it. So today we're going to be talking about Edmund Kemper III, or just Ed Kemper, who was known as the co-ed killer. Now, a quick disclaimer before we get started. If you are offended by dismemberment or someone kind of using comedy in like a true crime scenario, why are you watching this video? You clearly know my personality by now. I'm gonna poke fun at things sometimes. That's just how I deal with life in general, how I deal with trauma, and how I make lighter of horrible, horrible situations, okay? Sorry about it. Also, this video is intended for mature audiences only, so what are you doing here? Are you 12? Get out of here. Alrighty, so let's go ahead and get into it. Usually I have a snack. I'm drinking my tea right now. For some reason, I have chocolate pudding right here. I'm definitely gonna fuck that up in a second. Anyways, so Edmund Kemper was born the 18th of December in 1948, and he's the middle child of two other sisters. So younger sister and older sister, and then Edmund smack dab in the middle. His father, also Edmund, the previous Edmund, was a World War II vet, and his mom and his dad's relationship wasn't the best. His dad was quoted saying that his experience at wartime and basically war itself was nothing compared to how horrible it was being married to his wife. So she sounds delightful. Now, Edmund's mother was allegedly a bitch to everyone and just a horrible person. There are certain accounts that say that she was more verbally and emotionally abusive to Edmund, and not his sisters, but just to him. But then Edmund said that she did progress onto like beating him. But of course, can't really like trust what he says too much on like certain things because he is a genius basically and very manipulative. So I had to keep reminding myself of that when I was watching interviews with him, because it was like, it's crazy. If you watch an interview with him, at first you're like, this guy's a psycho killer. And then like an hour into it, you're like, I kind of get what he's saying. And then I'm like, wait, no, that's not how this works. So the relationship between Edmund, I don't want to call him Edmund. It sounds weird. I'm just going to call him Ed. So the relationship between Ed and his mother was not off to a good start anyways when he was younger, because apparently she didn't want to like hug him or love on him or coddle him or really just like be lovey towards him at all, because she didn't want to, quote, turn him gay. You know how hugs turn you gay? And of course, like a lot, I'm not gonna say most, but like a lot of serial killers, they have one of two things or both things, actually multiple. So a lot of times you'll hear of, you know, that abuse when they're younger from like a parent. Primarily it's like mommy issues, and then you'll hear of head injuries or multiple head injuries if you're Bobby Joe Long. He had like 11 head injuries. That video is crazy. Like I said, it's up there. And then also killing animals too. So Ed had, from what I know and what I saw on there, what all the research I did, all the interviews I watched of him, everything I read, he had two of those. So it was the abuse from his mother and like the weird relationship there, and then the killing of like cats and stuff when he was younger. Not just cats, it was other animals as well, but like smaller innocent animals basically. All animals are innocent, but you get it. Okay, so by the time Edmund was like before even 10 years old, he was really just turning into just a little creep. So he would follow his second grade teacher
home, like to her house, and just like stand outside her house. And then apparently he was like holding a knife too, like one of his dad's knives. It was apparently like a bayonet, apparently, and that's like the stabby knife, like the long knife that goes on the end of a gun. But apparently he did that. And his younger sister, in an interview, Edmund even said this, that his younger sister was poking fun at him one day, and she was like, oh, you want to kiss your teacher, like you're in love with him or in love with her. And then Edmund's response was, well, if I kissed her, I'd have to kill her first. He said that like he started having like sexual fantasies revolving around like death and violence and things like that when he was about like as early as like 8 years old. And what he says that this came about because of his mother, basically. And he just had all of this rage towards her. And one thing as well, and hearing him kind of explain it again, he's very manipulative, but hearing it, now I don't want to say hearing his side of it, but hearing him like describe it too. Apparently his mother had his two sisters sleep upstairs in their home, and then downstairs in the basement, that's where she would have him sleep. And it wasn't like a finished basement. It wasn't like a nice basement. The way he was describing it sounded like a creepy dungeon. So he would have to walk down the stairs. And there are some interviews I saw that, or things I read, that it said that his mother like locked him down there. So he had to go down there, and there was like the stairs were, there was no railing. It was just like wood stairs. And he said they were really steep. He'd walk down there. It would be really dark. He'd have to close the door behind him and walk in the dark over to this like utility sink where there was one bulb, like one light downstairs. He'd like turn that on, and I guess like so he could see where he was going, but then he'd have to turn it off and walk all the way across like the whole length of the house. And that's where his little like twin bed was, where he slept. And that just sounds really sad. And of course, I'm not justifying anything he did, obviously, but I'm really crazy with trying to figure out why these people do these things. And I'm not saying I can understand it, but it does sound like he had a pretty shitty childhood. One way that he explains it is that, which is kind of strange, he's like, the way I saw it is that I was being punished and I was going down into hell, and there were like demons down there, and there was a furnace down there, and like the main floor of the house was, you know, earth, the middle ground, and then my sisters and my mother were going upstairs to heaven. And that just, I don't know, that's like, does an 8-year-old think that deeply? All right, so in 1957, Edmund the previous, if you will, his dad got the hell out of there, and he just left his three kids with their alcoholic mother. Now, apparently after his father left, the emotional abuse and mental abuse and just verbal attacks from his mom got a lot worse since his dad wasn't there. Another little creepy tidbit from their childhood is that Edmund would have his sister, he says it was just one of the sisters, other interviews and things like that and records say, not records, but articles say that it was both the sisters. But anyways, he would have them go down to the basement with them and play this game called Gas Chamber, which doesn't really make sense. However, the game in general doesn't make sense. It just is gross and sounds like he was like getting off. But basically he would tie them up and blindfold them and wouldn't let them go. And they would like be struggling and they had to like try to get out. And then another part of the game is that you had to roll someone up in a rug and then try to get them out of the room, like out of the basement without any help. So it's like, are you just practicing? What are you doing? So sounds like a totally normal and really fun game. Me and my brother just played Legos and like Barbies and G.I. Joes and like Manhunt and just played on the trampoline. Like we weren't rolling each other up in rugs and pretending to kidnap each other, but to each their own, I guess. So one thing that Edmund said in an interview that I thought was very interesting, and yes, I watched multiple interviews with him, each one creepier than the next. So one thing that he said, it was that he was at this record shop when he was younger. I believe he was like early, I want to say like preteen-ish, maybe like 11 or 12. And he said that he went to this record shop and there was like this magic show display thing being set up. And there was like a crowd of kids or teenagers. And the magician was doing a trick where there was a guillotine and he was going to like chop someone's head off. Obviously, he's not going to chop someone's head off. It's just a magic trick. So he saw this beautiful girl walk up and like volunteer or whatever. And he said he was just fascinated with the fact that like her head was going to be chopped off and that she was like happy about it or excited. And he specifically talks about that. And when he's explaining it, it's just Creep City, because it seems like it's really like a fond memory of his. And another thing that people always refer back to is, well, he would, you know, take the heads off of his sister's dolls. And I'm like, okay, but my brother did that too, and he's not a murdering psychopath. So he would also take like my older ones and like use them as target practice with his BB gun. Julian's not a psycho killer, I promise. He's my best friend. He's amazing. He's also a turd, but he's amazing. And also in many of the interviews that I watched, when they do bring that up, Edmund says, he's like, it's funny that people take that, and it's crazy how like eloquent he is. You know, you would expect him to be erratic and just crazy, but he's not. He's a very good storyteller, which while I was watching it, I was like, I can understand how good he is at manipulating. Like, I feel like he's manipulating me right now. I'll link some of those down below. There's actually a whole article that I found that has like multiple of them in there. So I'll link that down below, and then other sources and stuff I found too. But he goes back to that and he says, you know, a lot of people think, well, oh, he always, popped the heads off of the dolls. He's like, that was one specific instance where me and my sister got in a fight and she like messed up his pellet gun or some like toy he like loved and was really happy about, and she, I guess, was jealous or something. He said she was jealous, and they got in a fight and she messed it up, so then he went over to her doll and popped off the head. But you can easily just like put it back on. So he popped off the head and then like cut the like neck off, I guess, so that she couldn't just pop the head back on. If you had Barbies growing up, you know, you can just pop off the head, which is kind of weird, especially because like all the bodies are basically the same. Why would you like want to, I don't know. Anyway, so then he also cut off the hands too, just to like as an extra fuck you. But that's also very interesting, is that he did that later on though too, but also he did dismember the bodies as well. So it's not like he just cut off the hands and the head. Anyways, moving on. Like I said before, he did kill their family cat. He actually buried it alive, so it like died that way. And then he killed another cat, I guess just like a neighborhood, like outside cat or something. He shot that one with a BB gun or with a knife or something like that. Like actually killed it and then buried it too. Okay, we're done with the childhood. So by age 14, Edmund was already over 6 feet tall, which is, that's a big bitch. So I'm not saying, again, like, it's understandable that, like, his mom put him in the basement. But apparently what sources say is that she was, like, scared for her daughter's safety and didn't want him to hurt them, I guess. But it's also like, okay, well, are you really doing that much by just having him sleep in the basement? What are you doing, mom? So Edmund also said that he just really hated being with his mom. And he went to go visit, this was when they lived in like Montana, and he went to go visit his dad in Van Nuys or in like the Southern California area, and he visited him for about 30 days, and he loved being able to hang out with his stepbrother. His dad had already gotten remarried and had another kid, and he loved being able to just kind of not be on his own, but be like treated as an adult down there and not just ridiculed and abused basically like he was with his mother. So he was there for about a month, and then he came back home, and he said that that's when there was really an even worse rift between him and his mother, because she would, you know, say certain things to him and then it wouldn't really have an effect on him. So the abuse got worse and worse, is from Ed's own account, is what he says happened. So after that, Edmund actually went to live with his father full time, and he lived with them for, I want to say, almost a year. And then him and his dad and his stepbrother and stepmother went to his dad's parents, so his paternal grandparents' house on their farm that they had down in Southern California, for Christmas. And his dad left him there because he was like, you're just causing too much stress for the family. Edmund says that it was because his stepbrother and stepmother were like fighting for like the love of, like they were competing, I guess, for like the dad's attention against him. And other articles said that it was more so he was just really annoying and creeping out the stepmother, which from everything I can see, I can kind of understand. So apparently everything was fine for about 10 months that he was there. He was going to a school that he liked, and his grandmother was, you know, trying to undo everything that had been like instilled in him with the mother. And she, you know, said, oh, you know, it's gonna be different. And then after a while it was more of the same. So she kind of just was worse, I guess, and she was very domineering. And that's what Edmund says, is that he really hated when they were very domineering. And I personally think that's why he, like, there's a side of him that really like hated women, is because that's what he grew up with, was a very domineering household, not only, you know, the first first household he was in, but then the second one as well. So his grandfather decided to get him a gun, and he gave that to him so that he could shoot like rabbits and gophers and other critters, or like armadillos, things like that, like vermin basically on their farm. And then he started shooting like bigger things, like not that a bird is bigger than that, but like things that he like wasn't instructed to kill, things that aren't like causing havoc on the farm, right? Innocent animals. I say innocent because like they weren't pests, basically. It was just like an animal. So his grandmother started seeing that, and she was like, okay, we should probably like take the gun away. And his grandfather was like, no, it's fine, it's fine, we need to like give him like an outlet. And it's like, you don't give someone who needs an outlet for their anger a gun. What are you doing? So one morning, his grandmother and Edmund, his grandfather was away running errands or something, and him and his grandmother got in an argument in the kitchen, and he just got so angry, and all of this had just been building up inside of him. He walked out of the room. His grandmother was sitting at the kitchen table. He came up to her and shot her 3 times in the head and killed her, obviously. And he decided that once his grandfather got home, that he was going to shoot and kill him too, because he didn't want his grandfather to have to deal with the loss of his wife, which it's like, are you really trying to justify that? Like, I'm pretty sure you don't care because you killed his wife. So then his grandfather got home, pulls up to the house. Before he even gets to the front steps of the house, he is shot and killed by Edmund. So then Edmund calls his mother and he's like, hi, I just did this. And his mother says, okay, call the cops, tell them what you did, and go sit on the front porch until they come and get you. So he did. And when he is taken in to police custody, they interview him and ask him. And obviously he says everything that happened, told them what happened. And they were like, well, why'd you do it? And his response was, I just wanted to see what it was like to kill someone. So that's horrifying. Now keep in mind, he's 15, only 15 years old, 6 feet tall, but plus he's a giant basically, but he's only 15 when this happens. So they have a bunch of healthcare professionals and doctors and people come in and give him tests and see, you know, is there an underlying mental health issue, which clearly there is. It's called being a psychopath. And then they also give him an IQ test, which is kind of weird, but also like I can kind of understand that though. So they could see like, okay, does he have the mental capacity to understand what he did? Which he does, because he scored a 136, which is crazy off the charts, like real good. And then he took it again and got a 140, which is like genius level. But not only is he a genius, but he is also diagnosed as psychotic and paranoid, which obviously those don't mesh well. So then Ed was sent to a maximum security facility for mentally ill criminals. And when he was there, he went through, you know, weekly testing, therapy sessions, group sessions, things like that. And he's so good at manipulating that he, you know, got, and he's so smart really, that he got close to the doctors and the instructors and the staff members. So they started to trust him more. So they kind of gave him, you know, more privileges. And some of the staff members and doctors would even have him, you know, grade some of the tests, or, you know, run little like errands, you know, within the facility, and, you know, here, take these results to here and there and stuff like that. But as he's doing all that, he's learning, you know, exactly what they need to hear for him to get out and for them to kind of just let him go, right? So after only 5 years, he's let out because he's low risk and he's fine. He's fine. He only killed his grandparents because he wanted to see what it felt like to kill. So totally normal. And when he got out, he was 21 years old and his record was expunged, which means that whatever happened before just doesn't exist. Just wiped that shit clean, because those murders don't matter. So basically he was let out. He was on like a probation, or I don't want to say parole, but it was more like a probation where he did have to keep checking in with these doctors and these like court appointed like appointments and things like that. But again, he's so smart and so great at manipulating people and telling them what they're going to hear. They were fine with him basically, all the while he's going to go down this insane and even worse path. One thing that they told him was, you should not move back in with your mother, because clearly that's not a good relationship. So the facility he was in is in Southern California now, or some part of California. I'm not really familiar with California. I am, but like only a little bit. Now his mother had actually moved to the Santa Cruz area because she got a job at the University of California. So he moved back in with her. Great. The one thing they told you not to do. Also, they told you not to murder anyone, but we see how that went. Edmund was kind of a nomad. He would, you know, have different jobs and have different apartments and live in different places. And then whenever he just ran out of money or couldn't find a job or whatever, he would come back and live with his mom. And then in 1971, he got a job with the Department of Transportation transportation. But what he really wanted to do was be a law enforcement officer. However, he couldn't because apparently he exceeded the height requirement because he was 6'9" and he's like 300 pounds. He wasn't fat. Like he was a big dude. But in my mind, I'm like, why would you have a maximum height requirement? Like that doesn't really make sense. And I get it. It's like the 70s. Nothing makes sense. I get that. But in my mind, I'm like, maybe that was just what they told him because he like didn't pass the psych eval. But then again, he passed the years of psych evals prior to that. So that's obviously not the case. So maybe, hey, it's the 70s. Things don't make sense. Maybe they really did have a maximum height requirement, which sounds so dumb. Although he couldn't be an actual law enforcement officer, he was still friends with a lot of the cops in the area. And so he would hang out in like the same places as them and they would call him Big Ed. Ed drove a motorcycle, but then one day he was in a motorcycle accident and it wasn't his fault. So he got about $15,000 from the person who was actually at fault for the accident, and his head or his arm, I think both maybe, were injured. So he like couldn't really do anything after that. He couldn't work. He couldn't do anything. So he was just about to do something else that we'll talk about. However, with that money that he had now, he bought a car. And what car did he buy? A car that looked like a, you know, an old cop car, right? So basically today's version of buying like an unmarked, like a Crown Vic. A lot of people will go to like auctions and buy old cop cars basically that just have like a shit ton of mileage on them. And then that's why you'll see sometimes people driving around that clearly aren't cops. You can like clearly tell they're not cops, and it'll, you know, have like a shitty paint job or something, and it'll have like everything stripped off of it, and you think it's a cop. You get nervous if you're like smoking weed in your car and you're like, oh my god, that's a cop, and you're like, oh, it's not, some random guy. Anyways, he did that, and it just adds to like the creepy level of like, okay, wannabe cop, calm down. But now that he's not doing anything because he's out of work, he can't work because he's all jacked up, he decides to practice. Practice what, you might ask? No, no, no. Not playing the drums, not drawing, not the clarinet. God forbid he get a different skill in life and put his genius to work. He starts the practice picking up hitchhikers and being, quote, non-threatening, being approachable, and basically acting like a normal human that they would want to get in a car with. So he does this for a few months and it doesn't actually, you know, kill any of them. They all get to their destination. So one day, he picks up Mary Ann and Anita, two college students, and unfortunately they do not get to their destination. They were hitchhiking. I'm assuming they were going home. They didn't get home. A while later, their families reported them missing, and a little bit after that, some hikers in the area found what turned out to be Mary's head in the forest. Just her head, that's it. And Anita's body would never be found. So Ed said later in an interview that he picked up the girls, he killed both of them, he took their bodies back to his apartment, and he got freaky with the bodies. He decapitated them, dismembered the bodies and everything. And this is a gross part. For lack of a more gruesome way of explaining this, he put his dick in it. He did the sexual things with the dead bodies. One thing he also did is after he did all of that, he like drove around like that huge area and like scattered the body parts so they would like never be found like together. Now let's fast forward to September 1972, and he picked up another hitchhiker. And I'm probably gonna mess up her name, but it's Aiko, I'm assuming is how you say her name. And she actually tried to escape him, but didn't get away. So he tried to suffocate her by like taping her mouth and then sticking his big ass sausage fingers in her nostrils. Clearly that didn't work. So then he just took her scarf that she was wearing and just strangled her with it. So she died. And then after she was already dead, he did the sexual things. But then, like the truly bold psychopath that he is, with her body still in the trunk of his car, he then decides, I'm gonna go get a drink with my pals. So he goes to the bar where him and his cop friends hang out with her body still in the car, hangs out with them, has a drink, and then gets back in his car, takes her to the apartment, dismembers her body. Now, one thing that I think is like, just from reading everything and seeing everything, I think he really got off. I don't know if that's the right phrase to use, but I feel like he really got off on the fact that he was smarter than everyone. And the whole thing of, you know, having the body in the car while you're in there with a bunch of cops, and like he can't get caught. He's smarter than them. He knows better than them. Even with the manipulation of the people at the facility, like I just feel like that was the ego, like that's the mentality. That's just my opinion, obviously, my non-professional opinion. So he gets home, like I said, he dismembers the body and he puts her hands and her head in a bag, and then he's like, oh shit, I have to go to one of my court appointed appointments, like one of those things, and run some other errands. Like killing her was on his list to do, but it wasn't like the only thing he had to do. He was real busy. So he went there, ran his errands, went to that appointment with her head in her hands in a bag in his car. Like, I feel like bold is a good way to describe him, because it's just like, he thinks he's smarter than everyone. He's gonna go to this appointment and be like, see, I am low risk, I'm normal. And then, I also have a human head in hands of a woman that I just killed and brutalized in my car. So there's that. So then after he finishes everything on his to-do list, he disposes of the rest of her body. So in 1973, he also picked up another girl. Her name was Cindy. And this time he actually shot and killed her. And he took the body to his mom's house and hid the body there while his mom was gone. And then he dismembered the body. He kept the head. He threw the rest of her body in the ocean. And then he buried her head in the backyard. And this part was like real creepy when I heard him say it. He said that he buried the head in a way that she was like looking up at his mother's bedroom, like up to the second story window of his mother's bedroom, because his mother always wanted people to look up to her. It's like he's doing all of this to get back at his mom, but his mom doesn't know, but he doesn't just kill his mom. It doesn't make sense. I mean, is it ever gonna make sense? I mean, he does kill his mom. Sorry, spoiler, we'll get there. Still a lot more to go. So February 5th of 1973, Ed and his mom got in a huge fight. And instead of just killing his mom at that point, he stormed out of the house. He took the little like badge access parking pass thingy for the college that she worked at. Because remember, she works at a college. We already talked about that. He took that and went and like drove there and parked there. And Ed said, and I quote, "The next pretty girl I see is going to die." So he saw two pretty girls. Their names were Rosalind and Alice. So he picked up both of them, and instead of stopping and killing them, he, while driving, turned around and shot one of them and then shot the other one. And this was like at, like it was darker by then. So he drove into an area like the side of the road or like a dead end or something where there it like wasn't as well lit. He put the bodies in his trunk and then again decapitated them, dismembered the other parts of the body, and dispersed them in different locations. Now, it wasn't until Rosalind and Alice, one of their heads was found in a wooded area in the like Santa Cruz area. It wasn't until one of their heads was found when anyone even like had caught on to like someone was murdering people. But the thing is that there were two other serial killers basically at that same time in that area. So it's kind of like you're like getting lost in the mix, but some other, you know, heads or body parts were found as well. And so they were kind of piecing together, you know, this one is a little bit different than these other ones. So authorities were kind of piecing together, you know, okay, this is clearly, you know, someone else. And that's when they coined the co-ed killer, because it was all, you know, women usually of like the same age in college. So all of that happened in February of 1973. And then in April 1973, Ed went to his mother's house and they got in, what do you know, surprise, surprise, another fight. So then she went to sleep and he did not. He went and got a hammer and then he just kept hitting her until she died while she was asleep. So, I mean, that's kind of one positive thing, was while she was sleeping. But what's not positive is what happened next. Again, trigger warning. Also, if you need a trigger warning during these videos, why are you watching them? But it's gonna get disgusting again. So he dismembered her body, decapitated her, and then proceeded to take her severed head and put his dick in it. Cause that's what he does with everyone's head, apparently. He's just gotta put his dick in it. So he did that. And from his own account, what he said he did was he put her head on like the mantle of the fireplace, like where you like hang your stockings, just put her head there, and then used it as like a dartboard and started like throwing shit at it. And then he said that he proceeded to cut out her larynx, which is the voice box, and her tongue. And then he put those in the garbage disposal, which is, I don't want to say it's like poetic, but it sounds like something that someone in like a movie would do. Like, she verbally, emotionally, like used her voice to abuse him for so long, and he was clearly tired of it, then finally killed her after he'd already killed all these other people as like a surrogate. So he took out her tongue and that so that she couldn't yell at him anymore. But it's like, dude, she's dead. She can't yell at me anymore now. You don't have to do all that. Very extra. So not that any of it makes sense to me, but this part really doesn't make sense to me at all. So he put the tongue and the larynx in the garbage disposal. He said that it like wouldn't chop it up. It kept like spitting it back out, I guess, which it's like, what do you expect? Like it's like body parts. But he said that he called his mom's best friend and she came over like for dinner, I guess. And she came over and of course, what does he do? Have a nice dinner with her and then say, okay, bye. She walks in the door. He strangles her. She's dead. And then what does he do with a dead body? Can't just dismember it and leave it alone or just not murder people. He, let's say it together, has to put his dick in it. That's what he did. So he did the sexuals with her dead body. And then the next day, he took the mom's best friend's car and drove like a while, went to a car rental place, left her car there, got a rental car, and then drove straight 18 hours. He says that he only stopped for gas and soda, and I assume to tinkle. I mean, you're gonna have to go pee. So he hardly made any pit stops, basically. And then once he hit Colorado, and he called the Santa Cruz police and confessed to everything. Now keep in mind, he's friends with these guys. So they're like, oh, very funny, Ed. Like, no, you didn't do that. Shut up. Like, this is not you. You didn't commit all these murders. So instead, he goes to the local police, turns himself in, then they hand him over to the Santa Cruz police, and they're like, holy fuck, okay. So then they actually start to believe him once he goes into like crazy detail and takes them to all of these disposal sites, which since there were so many of them, they were like, is this ever gonna end? Because there's so many and they're like looking for things. So then obviously he was arrested. And that was on April 28th, 1973. He was arrested and he was only 24 years old. That's crazy. He was charged with 8 counts of murder, obviously found guilty. We all know that, right? And then I saw a few things that said that he's serving 8 consecutive life sentences, but in 2 different interviews, he was saying that that's not 8 consecutive life sentences, it's 8 concurrent life sentences. There were a few times where he, you know, later on, he tried to, you know, take his confessions back and tried to do other pretty manipulative things to say like, oh no, you were building a case against me. So I thought if I confessed, like it would be better for me to like plead insanity. And it didn't really, to me at least, I mean, he's a genius, so he would know better, I guess. But to me, it didn't really make sense why he would do that. But obviously they're like, nah, you did it. You put your wiener in those severed heads. You did that, sir. And then he was actually up for, parole, right? Yeah. He was up for parole and they were like, no, you're staying. So obviously he's still in prison. He has done a lot of interviews. Like I said, I'll put them in the description box. And then also he gets a lot of fan mail and apparently he answers all of them. There are a few weird quotes from his interviews. There's one that he said that's whenever he saw, or even still to this day sees, a pretty girl, he's like, oh, you know, one part of him thinks, oh, she's very pretty, you know, I'd like to take her out, I'd like to go on a date with her, you know, talk to her, get to know her. And then the other part of me thinks, I wonder what her head would look like on a stick. Okay. And then there's another quote where he was talking about his, like, the night that his mother died, aka the night that he murdered his mother, and he started breaking down in tears. And he said, and I quote, I'm not a lizard. I'm not from under a rock. I came out of her vagina. End quote. Ew. Like, okay, we know. I think he was probably trying to be like, I'm not a monster. And like, how could I do that to her? But it's also like, you did it. It's very, this entire, like, this is one that is just so strange because I feel like with so many of these serial killers, oh, that's it, by the way. But I feel like with so many of the serial killers that we talk about and true crime cases and all this stuff, like, a lot of times we're not dealing with someone who is so smart. You know, I guess Ted Bundy would be a good example. He was very intelligent. He was more arrogant though, for sure. And that's what really messed him up. He was very, very manipulative. And obviously he was way more attractive than this ogre, this monster of a man. But that also helped Ted Bundy, and he really fed into that. You know, he knew he was very attractive and he played on that and played on the fact that a lot of people were like, oh my God, he couldn't have done it. Look at him. He's so attractive. You can be attractive and still fucking murder people. But again, he was smart, and I think I might do one on him too, but since he's one of the like heavy hitters, but he was smart enough to use that, but his arrogance got in the way. And then with Ed Kemper, he's really fucking smart and so eloquent, and it's so weird to try to understand. And I think that aspect of there being like two sides of them really comes into play there. And I think, I don't know, it's terrifying that someone can be that eloquent and just smart and like that, but then also a complete monster who puts his wiener in decapitated heads. Like, Edward, what are you doing? Or Edmund, whatever the fuck your name is. So creepy. So anyways, I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you're not just completely terrified
terrified by how awful this was. Because I am, honestly. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed, and I hope you have a great rest of your day. If you would like to watch any of my other true crime videos, definitely click up there. I love making these videos, so if y'all want to watch those and, you know, I don't know, share them or something, and if those do get more views, then yes, I will be doing more true crime videos. But the thing that sucks is that they don't really get a lot of views, so if I want this to be my full-time job, then I have to, like, put more effort into videos that do make more money. So, you know, anyways, I appreciate you. Stay safe, stay spicy, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye!